The harmful algal blooms in western Lake Erie have been a problem for years. Climate change is likely to bring increased precipitation and more frequent storms, and both of those factors could make the blooms worse.
Every summer, usually around the beginning of July, western Lake Erie transforms into something resembling pea soup.
We are on Lake Erie, headed to Luna Pier. The week after the forecast, we started seeing the bloom start, and the bloom has grown almost exponentially since then.
Eddie Verheim is a project engineer with Limnotech. A good part of his summer is spent maintaining environmental monitoring buoys on Lake Erie.
So we've seen it almost double, triple, quadruple in size in about a 2-week period. So it's covering about 300 square miles right now.
Eddie is one of an army of scientists and researchers who have converged on Lake Erie to study and predict harmful algal blooms.
Many of these freshwater blooms, they're actually a type of bacteria that are referred to as cyanobacteria.
Dr. Gregory Dick is a research scientist at the University of Michigan. His lab's research is helping us understand the genetic makeup of harmful algal blooms in Lake Erie.
So these cyanobacteria are the organisms that originally invented oxygen-producing photosynthesis billions of years ago. But for historical reasons, they've also been called blue-green algae, and that sort of informal name sticks with the cyanobacteria. The blooms that we're seeing in Lake Erie represent an unnatural flux of nutrients.
Understanding and predicting harmful algal blooms in Lake Erie begins deep inside the agricultural heartland of Ohio.
When you think of anything that even us, anything that anybody needs to live, we have a certain number of nutrients that are required. You know, the first thing is carbon.
Dr. Laura Johnson is the director of the National Center for Water Quality Research at Heidelberg University. Her team tracks nutrient data, which help predict the scale of blooms in Lake Erie.
Plants, they can fix carbon from photosynthesis. But the other two big things we need is nitrogen and phosphorus. So phosphorus is just one of those things that we need to apply to soil to make sure that we get good crop growth. Turns out, if you apply something to the soil that can run off, you know, algae, even cyanobacteria, they're not all that different from the plants you're trying to encourage to grow. And if that stuff runs off and gets into a lake, they're encouraged to grow too. In those situations, when you get a lot of runoff, that's when you start to see big algae blooms.
When you have lots of nutrients and you have warm temperatures in the summertime and you have calm waters, that is conducive to the growth of what we call bloom-forming bacteria, cyanobacteria, that grow to really high densities and that produce certain toxins, certain molecules that are of concern due to their toxicity.
We started detecting harmful algal blooms in Lake Erie in the late 1990s. They were large enough to see from satellites starting in about 2002. The five worst blooms that we've ever seen on Lake Erie have all occurred since 2011. The problem's getting worse.
And we're getting close to the water intake crib for the city of Toledo. There's a funnel there that goes back to the pump station on shore.
During 2014, there was a very large algal bloom very close to the water intake crib, but the city didn't really know that the bloom was there until they started sucking it into their water intake. Bad water was already at the plant. That was when the Toledo water crisis happened. Folks couldn't drink water in the city.
It was the highest toxicity of any of the blooms in the last 4 or 5 years.
Dr. Bricks Stump is an oceanographer with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's National Centers for Coastal Ocean Science.
For a drinking water plant, it's really easy to remove the toxin if it's in the cells. You just settle the cells out, all the toxin's gone. If the toxin's dissolved in the water itself, not in the cells, they have to use chemical treatment. It's harder to do, harder to get rid of it. All these cells were being broken open, releasing all of their toxin, and this is a really toxic bloom. And it was early, so the combination was a surprise. It won't happen again. Might happen somewhere else. Won't happen in Toledo, because we now have things we didn't have in 2014 in July.
500,000 Toledo residents experienced a 72-hour drinking water crisis as a result of harmful algal blooms in 2014. Since then, a web of monitoring sondes, or sensors, have been deployed as sentinels for water quality and public health
We're coming up on our buoy. This is the LimnoTech water quality weather buoy that was installed about 2 weeks after the water crisis, and it's been here every summer since then. We have a water quality sensor on this buoy. It's measuring turbidity, it's measuring chlorophyll, how green is the water. We're also measuring for harmful algae or blue-green algae.
Andy McClure is the water administrator at Toledo's Collins Park Water Treatment Plant.
In 2014, we didn't have the data science. We couldn't react quickly to changes in the lake. Like, we knew lake conditions were changing several hours after they've already changed. So that's one of the big things at data science, you know, the buoy and the science in our intake grid and low service. We know right away when water quality is changing.
So when there's a bloom going on, we combine instruments in the water, water samples, and a satellite data and say, here's where the bloom is now, here's how toxic it is, this is where we expect it to be tomorrow, the next day.
Whereas we've gotten pretty good at forecasting the size and movement of blooms, we're in the very early stages of being able to forecast or predict toxicity. And so that's where we're hoping some of the studies that my lab and others are doing are gonna inform models that could allow us to make forecasts and predictions about toxicity.
We know that the harmful algal blooms are driven by the amount of phosphorus that comes in during the spring. The spring of 2011 and the spring of 2015 were incredibly wet springs. As a result, we had huge amounts of phosphorus go into the lake, and we had the biggest blooms that we've ever seen. We want to keep the agricultural production high. We need that food. If everyone would not apply more than is needed and would insert it into the soil when it was applied, those two actions alone would reduce the amount of phosphorus leaving the agricultural fields by over 60%, and we only need a 40% reduction.
So if you listen to anybody these days talking about how do we fix this problem, that's one of the things that always seems to come up. It's a nutrient management issue. I think we have a lot of good theories as to exactly why we've seen these dissolved phosphorus losses and then what practices are going to fix them. But we haven't been able to see that play out on the ground as much as we would like.
Adding to the challenges of balancing agricultural production and managing nutrients, the scientific community is now grappling with an emerging driver of bloom formation, climate change.
We haven't even made a little bit of progress in reducing that flow-weighted mean concentration. We've got to take this much more seriously. We now know that 70 to 90% of the phosphorus that comes into the lake comes in during the 10 worst storm events each year, and we're seeing every year more frequent severe storms.
The frequency and the size and the magnitude of these blooms is increasing. That has been well documented, and it's thought that that is tied to this excess nutrients, so increasing amounts of nutrients that are coming into natural waterways. It also has to do with climate change, both in terms of increasing temperatures as well as increasing precipitation, which increases nutrient loads from land into lakes.
The overarching looming thing that we're gonna be challenged with moving forward is climate change. You know, we're seeing more extremes on both ends of the spectrum. If we have more intense rain events early in the spring, followed by drought conditions later in the summer, that is worst case scenario for bloom formation, because hot, dry, long periods of time after we've had big inputs into the lake, that leads to big blooms. And so the question is, well, if that's our scenario and that's what's gonna be happening moving forward, then we need to be prepared. In mid-century, because of climate change, it might just lead us to where we are right now, which means we're maintaining the current frequency of severe blooms, which is good, but then that means we haven't made any progress. We need to come up with some new technologies and novel ideas with how to deal with lots of water moving across the ground, and then subsequently no water.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.